Hello and welcome to Session 7, Use DAX Functions in Power BI. I'm Andrew Conniff, a Microsoft technical trainer specializing in data and AI, and today we will explore DAX functions in Power BI. Let's dive in. In this session, we are going to discuss understanding and manipulating filter context, using DAX functions to extend semantic models, and creating custom date tables for time intelligence. Filter context in DAX refers to the set of filters applied to data influencing how the calculations and measures are computed and displayed. For example, these three visuals use the exact same DAX measure, total sales. The first visual shows the total sales measure without any filters. The second visual is filtered by year, meaning year was added to that visual. The third visual, total sales, is filtered by product ID, meaning total sales and product ID are both on the visual. With Power BI, even though the measure was only defined once, it can be used in these visuals in different ways. Each of the totals is accurate and performs quickly. It is the context of how the DAX measure is used that calculates these totals accurately. The calculate function in DAX is one of the most important functions that a data analyst can learn. The function name does not adequately describe what it is intended to do. The calculate function is our method for creating a DAX measure that will override certain portions of the context that are being used to express the correct result. So for example, if you want to create a measure that always calculates the total sales for 2015, regardless of which year is selected in any other visual in Power BI, you will be creating a measure that is similar to the syntax of the following example. Total sales for 2015, calculate the sum of the sales order details, total price, comma, the year we pass in, order details, order date, and 2015. Notice how the measure is named total sales for 2015. When we calculate, when we use that, we use the function to override the context, and it's helpful to rename the measure in a way that describes exactly how we're overriding it. So when we pass in that date for 2015, that is replacing the filter context as a constant. So in this example, calculate is aggregating the total price column just as we did in the previous measures. However, instead of operating over the entire semantic model while using whatever the filter context tells it to do, we are overriding that for the filter context of the year 2015. So no matter what year is selected, we will always get the total for 2015. All the other filters still apply. The subsequent examples show this concept in action. When both measures are added to the previous visuals, they will resemble the following screenshot. As shown in the image, total sales will still be USD 1.3 million, while the 2015 total sales stays current at USD 0.66 million. Previously, we discussed creating multiple relationships between tables, but only one could be active. In order to leverage the inactive relationships, we're going to use DAX. This is known as role-playing dimension. In this image, we see the sales and date table with two relationships. The active relationship is between order date and date. See that we can filter by date to calculate the sales. However, if we also wanted to visualize the date by ship date, we need to use DAX. To enable filtering on ship date, we use the DAX function useRelationship. This function is used to specify a relationship to be used in a specific calculation and is done without overriding any existing relationships. It is a beneficial feature in that it allows developers to make additional calculations on inactive relationships by overriding the default active relationship between two tables and in a DAX expression. As shown in the example by sales by ship date, where the calculate to override the filters, and then we implement the useRelationship function to activate the relationship with ship date. With that measure created, we'll be able to create the bottom visual. Semi-additive measures are a powerful concept in Power BI when standard aggregation methods don't fit the data analysis requirements. Our slide shows a semi-additive measure called last sales quantity, which calculates the quantity of sales for the last date within a selected time period. The line chart shows each subcategory's quantity of sales by the last date in the year. When would we want to use a semi-additive measure like this? Consider a scenario where we need to analyze inventory or sales data based on a specific point in time rather than aggregating all of the dates. For example, if we wanted to understand the quantity of sales for the last day of each year or the last day of selected time period, the last sales quantity measure becomes invaluable. During Power BI report creation, it's often necessary to perform calculations on date and time. To effectively analyze date over time, creating a date table is crucial. The table provides the necessary formatting for time-oriented values and allows businesses to track performance over months, quarters, fiscal years, and more. Power BI includes an automatic date time feature that generates predefined calculated columns for day, month, quarter, and year. However, these columns may not meet the specific requirements or can unnecessarily increase model size. Disabling auto date time doesn't eliminate the need for time intelligence. This is where a common date table comes into play. Before creating a new common date table, it's advisable to check to see if there's already an existing one within the organization to avoid duplicating work. A common date table allows us to standardize date formats and ranges according to the company requirements. It can include additional details like company holidays, fiscal versus calendar dates, and more. By adding month, week, and day number columns, we can filter and aggregate data based on various data types. It's simplifying our complex calculations. We have three common ways to designate a date table in Power BI. Source data. Sometimes source databases or data warehouses already have their own date tables. We can use those. DAX functions, where we don't have an existing date table, we can use DAX functions like calendar auto or calendar to generate a common date table. And in Power Query, we can use the M language in Power Query to define a common date table. To designate the common date table as the official date table, we can write or context click its name in the fields pane and select mark as date table. While some time calculations are simple to do in DAX, others are more difficult. For instance, this screenshot shows what happens if we want to display a running total. Notice that the totals increment for each month, but then reset when the year changes. And in other programming languages, this result can be complicated and often involves several variables and looping through the code. DAX simplifies comparing current sales with previous periods, for example, to view the sales of this month next to last month's sales. This measure uses the calculate function, indicating that we are overriding the context to evaluate the expression. We are summing total price, and for the second argument, using previous month for the override, which tells Power BI that no matter what month is the default, the system override is to be the previous month. Now see the new visual using DAX measures. When examining the month side by side, notice that the total sales for July compared to the total sales for June. Calculating the difference between current and previous month is now available with the measure. Now let's move over to a demonstration to see some DAX functions in action.
Now let's try some advanced DAX. So we're going to create a matrix visual. This is a little bit bigger. And let's start adding some data. So we're going to add the regions hierarchy to this matrix. There you can see we have our hierarchy. And then also we're going to add the sales field. There we go. And we should now see the drill down. So there we can drill down and we can see that we have our sum of sales and or down through the hierarchy. Now in our visualizations pane here, make that a little wider. What we want to do is we want to find the layout. I want to open that up and we want to set this out to tabular. And we can now see that we have, there we go, four headers. Country, region, sales. When we drill all the way in, we have four headers. All right. And then what we want to do is we want to manipulate our filter context a little bit. And what we're going to do is we're going to create a DAX called sales of all region to the sales table. Sales, we'll do measure. All right. Now what we're going to do is we're going to use calculate. We're going to take the sum of the sales and remove the filters for region. Okay. And when that's done, add that to our matrix. So you have sales all region. That's all of our regions. And it's removed the filter. So no matter what we click on, it's going to stay the same. Now let's go update this. And we're going to do sales percentage all region. Let's make this a little bit more interesting. So if we open this up, we can update our DAX And what we're going to do here, now we're going to divide the sales with the calculate of the remove filter. So let's see what the percentage is on there. Go ahead and select that. And that should update our column. All right. And then we would want to set this to percentage. And there's our percentage. All right. Now, if we want to add sales percentage by country, that's going to be a new measure. So let's, and here you see we have the sum of sales, and then we're doing the calculate the sum and remove filters by region. And you might have guessed we're going to update this one as well. So I'm going to do sales of all, of sales percentage of country. Here you can see also we would need to format this. And we're getting quite a bit here. So let's see if we can do a little bit better on this. We're going to update our sales percentage by country and improve it. So let's do that. Let's keep this open. All right. So let's improve this calculation to say if it's in scope. So if is in scope. So we see we have several 100% and then we have some of these that are not happening. They're not getting everything. So let's execute this. We'll watch everything change. And as we drill in and out of our table, we notice the changes as they show up. So here we have our group, our country, and region. So we're in the region. And if we go back to the report, you can see here we have our pages. We can drill up, we can drill down, and let's add one for group. So if we say new measure, take everything we've learned, we'll do it all in one fell swoop this time. And here we're saying, hey, if this is in scope for the region or is in scope for the region country, so sales and group, divide that sales, and then we're going to divide by that calculate result. So where we are removing the filters for region and country. So we're saying if it's in there, we're going to put it in there, we're going to remove the filters. That's going to give us values that aren't then going to be filtered as we click around the page. Add that to our visual. And of course, we can drill up, drill down. Everything is starting to make a lot more sense. All right. In the model view, we've added these new measures. And let's clean this up a little bit. So we have our percentages. We select them all and display folder. Now we have them all in the ratios folder. All right, let's save this. And let's go ahead and add sales year to date. So we're gonna add a new measure. And you'll see we have our sum of sales, sales region, and we can add the sales year to date. Go back here, we see we have all of our lines from before, and we can add the sales and sales year to date. There we go. Then we can see that amount showing up. Let's take a quick walk through that one. So first, create a new measure. And here we're doing the variable, as we know to do, called sales prior year. And then we're going to return the result. So the sales prior year is this calculate phrase where we go back 12 months. And we would need to use this twice. And so we use it down here as sales prior year divided by sales prior year. And this is the part that we're going to return. So let's execute that and add that to our visual. There we go. And there's our year over year growth. Excellent. And now we get a sales year over year growth in a time percentage. And that brings us to the end of this demonstration.
This concludes our session. There are many ways to continue your learning journey. We encourage you to watch other videos in this course or search out your next favorite topic on Microsoft Learn at aka.ms/learn.